frames. Now, this is a frame. The difference between frames and trusses is that in the frames, the elements don't necessarily connect at the end of the elements. And the most important characteristic of a frame is that the elements have forces in the middle of the length. It's not like in the trusses that all the elements have only two forces. Remember, in the trusses, all the elements have just force at the tips. At the tips, right? Remember, it was just forces at the end, either compression or tension. So that was the only possibility on a truss. Now, if we're talking about frames, in the frames we have elements that have forces not only at the end, like the element C, F here, that has one force going down here, and there is another element coming in here, and there is another element coming in here. So now we have three forces. When we have three forces, this element is going to support what is called flexion. So this member can deform like this on there, due to the action of those forces, right? That never happens on a truss. On a truss element, you have the element, you have the force that stretches the element, so the element can stretch, or the element can compress. If you apply compression, the element can compress, so the element might get shorter, but never happens bending on a truss. Now we have frames. On frames, we have bending. That's the main difference on frames, bending. The rest basically is the same thing that we have been talking all the time. Free body diagram, equations of equilibrium, and solve for the equations. So let's get to it. Nothing new, only know the fact that some elements will have bending. So what you usually need to know or are asking these problems is, what are the forces on the connections and the reactions of the structure? That's basically what you need to find. And eventually you might want to find the internal forces on a given point on the element. For example, in the vertical element, you see a couple of points, H, and I. You eventually might be required to find the internal forces on that element. What does it mean, internal forces? If I have an element of a frame, let's put a very simple element here. Would be like a very simple beam. If I have this beam, this beam will be under bending here like this. So that means that the beam is rotating, in every point is rotating from the original, any section here now is like this. So the section rotated. If the section rotated, is because there was a moment somewhere. So that happens everywhere in the beam. So there will be an internal moment besides some other forces that can be there. So in a given section of a beam, let's cut it here. If I have the beam here, if I have this force here, I will have a force like this, and a moment. How do I know that I have those three forces? Because if I hold the beam from this side, suppose I grab it from this side very, very rigidly, there will be a force that is avoiding this side of the beam to go to the left or to the right. That's why, you know, it's the same analysis that we do when we are trying to get the forces on a support. You check if our free body diagram can move to the left or to the right, if our free body diagram can move to the up or down, or if we the free body diagram can rotate, then that's how we know the forces in the in that specific point. So if I hold this on this side, I think to myself, okay, can this left side of the beam move left or right? Not because they are perfectly fixed at the section. It's a continuous material. So it cannot move left or right. Can it move up and down? It cannot, so that's why there is a vertical force here. Can it rotate? No, it cannot rotate. So the section that I erase is avoiding the beam on the left to rotate. So those are the three forces that are produced in that section, and that I can see them as soon as I cut the beam. It's the same that we do when we do a support, right? If this support, does this support allow my beam to move left or right? No, so I can have a reaction like this. Can it move up and down? No, so I have a reaction like this. Can it rotate? No, so it has something like this. As opposed to if I have this kind of support, so in that kind of case, I have a force left or right because this cannot move left or right, a force up and down because this cannot move left up and down, but there is no moment. There is no moment because this can rotate easily, right? There is no restriction for the rotation. This can rotate. So that's why here I don't have moment. But in this case, I do have moment, and in this case, I do have moment too, because the beam is continuous at the section, so this cannot rotate. Only if instead of being a continuous beam, I have like a connection with a pin, because I have two elements like this. If I have this case, this, if I do a free body diagram of the left, well, this cannot move up or down because the other beam is holding it. This cannot move left or right. But this do can rotate, so there will be no moment because due to the pin, this element can rotate like that. So there is no moment. In this case, there is no moment. But that's not the case on a continuous beam. On a continuous beam, the fact that the beam is continuous, it doesn't allow the beam to rotate here. The only way this could rotate is if it breaks. If it breaks like that, you have a break. Let me increase the size of this. Only if the beam breaks, it will rotate, right? And when the beam breaks when the moment, the internal moment inside the beam is too big and it goes over the resistance of the material. In that case, the beam would break. So that's what we are going to do here in the analysis of frames. We are going to start the topic of analyzing these elements. So in the future, we will be able to design elements so they don't break due to the moment. Let me erase this stuff and come back. Okay, any question about that? So the idea, is that now the elements will have some kind of bending effect due to the forces that apply on them, and we can find the moment inside the element at any given point in a specific problem. We might be required to find the internal forces at a couple of points, and then we will see the moment inside the element, as well as the other two forces. Let me draw them again. So I have element here, element CE, and any given point here, I may have a cut, and then I will see a vertical force, horizontal force, and a moment. This horizontal force is an axial force that is trying to stretch the element or compress the element. This vertical force is called shear force. Shear force, axial force. The shear force, the vertical force that I label here shear, It's a for that strength to break the element. If I have here the bar inside my hands, so the shear force is a force that is trying to break the element like this. It's trying to break it like this. And the moment we discussed it already is the one that's going to break the element like this. It's going to break it like this. So shear is trying to break it like this. Moment is trying to break it like this. Let's try to analyze first the frame as regard to forces between the elements, the joints, and the reactions, and then we go more on internal forces. In order to analyze a frame like this, this is what we do. We have to break it in pieces. We will have one piece, which is the piece BE, and we have another piece that is the element CEF. So we have here BE and the CEF. Okay, see, I separate all the elements on the frame. And I have to do the free body diagram of each one of them. The element, the vertical element ABCD has a vertical force here due to that cable. Let's call it TD. At point C, you have the horizontal element that applies forces to this element. We don't know that force in what direction goes, so we draw the components. We call them CX and CY. Those are unknowns. It's just one force in a direction that we don't know. So the best way to approach these forces is to draw the components, the horizontal and vertical components. Once you draw the forces on a point like this one, C, you have to draw the forces on the same point in the other element, and the forces go exactly in the opposite direction, because this is a action-reaction pair from Newton's third law, okay? And then we go here on the point B. In this point B, you can gain a lot of time if you know that this element BE is an element that only have forces in two points. So if that's the case, remember that when you have an element subject only to two forces, those forces have to go collinear. So you know that this force here, B, and this force here, E, let's call it B and E. Those forces, we know the direction because it's the direction that joins the points D and E. That's the directions of the forces B and E. And being only two forces, you also know that B is equal to E. Force B is equal to E. That will save you a lot of time. If you don't do that, then you have here, instead of one unknown, B or E, because this is just one unknown, right? You will have to put, if you don't count with that fact, then you have to do here EX, EY, and then you have to do here DX, DY, and then you have four unknowns instead of one. So your problem gets much, much longer. So the first thing you have to do on a frame in order to reduce the amount of work that you have to do is check if you have any two forces elements. Any two forces element that you analyze by knowing this fact will save you a lot of time. Well, time is money. So we draw the B force. So in point B, we have to put the exact same force in the opposite direction. So we have here force B. It's a name that I don't like very much. I would like more to call it like F sub B, just a B sounds kind of a little bit confusing because it has the same name of the point. Okay, but you know what we're doing there. More forces. We have here at the reaction at the bottom, we have this support here on the left. The element cannot move up and down, so there will be a vertical reaction here, AY. And it cannot move left or right, so we have an horizontal reaction, AX. Again, you don't know the direction of any of those unknowns, so you can put any direction you want. And you know that after you do the solution, you find a negative sign, that force goes in the opposite direction. Any more forces? Well, also the force E, we put the force E, so we need to put the force E on the other element here, E, at the opposite direction of the one that we have in the other element, because it's another action-reaction pair from Newton's third law. Okay. Only missing here the force that is the cause of all the trouble, 5 kilonewtons. Due to these forces that we have everything in motion here. If we don't have this force, nothing will happen. So that's very important force. So that's how you disassemble the whole frame in order to analyze it. How do you analyze this? Well, you have to look at all the questions that you can establish here to solve. You have how many questions, how many unknowns? We have one, hold on, let me put it in another color here. We have one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, basically seven unknowns. So you have a bunch of work to do here, so you better find the questions that are easy. You don't want to have seven equations with seven unknowns or three equations with three unknowns. So we could start, let's see where can we start. We can start finding the reactions on the whole structure on the left. That's kind of one way to do it. So this way we can start on the left diagram. We use all this diagram here on the left to find AX and AY and the force here on the cable TD. I didn't like that. I will have to do a free body diagram of the whole structure. For time constraints, I am going to do it right here on top of the. So here on the left, I will have AY and AX, and then here on the top I will have tension D, and that will be the free body diagram. Well, I will remove the force here and I will draw 5 kilonewtons. That's the free body diagram of the whole frame. So here, if I do summation of moments about point A, I can find T sub D. Summation of moments about point A equals zero. I'm gonna do positive in this direction. And then I could do TD. This angle is 60 degrees. So I have the component here, 60 degrees. So TD cosine 60. And I have this other component here, the vertical component of TD doesn't produce moment because it goes directly to point A. So I only concern about the horizontal component, which is TD cosine 60 multiplied by the total height of the pole, which is 7. And that produces moments in the positive direction according to my convention. Now we have the 5 kilonewtons force. It produces a negative moment, 5 kilonewtons. If somebody tell me the distance, 4, exactly, 4. I don't see any more forces here that produce moment with respect to point X. So this is equal to 0. Therefore, TD equals to 20 kilonewtons meter positive, is negative, go positive to the other side, times 7 cosine 60 equals to 5.71 kilonewtons. We have TD, so we can put it here. 5.71. Now we can get AY with a summation of forces in the y direction equal to 0. AY, let's see if we want to do positive in the up direction. AY minus 5 kilonewtons minus TD that we just found, 5.71. Sine of 60 degrees equals to 0. Therefore, AY equals to 5 plus 5.7 sine 60. And what do we get here? 9.936. It's positive. It means that my first assumption was correct, so I have AY here equals to 9.936. And then we do summation of forces in the x direction. Summation of forces in the x direction equals to 0. I'm gonna do positive in this direction. So I have now AX. Remember, I am working with the free body diagram of the whole structure, right? I'm working with this diagram here. AX minus TD, which is 5.71 kilonewtons. Cosine 60. No more forces in the x direction, equal to 0. So AX equals to 5.71 cosine 60. Anybody can tell me how much is that? 2.855. Great. People is working really diligently today. 2.855. So we have now that solution. Perfect. All right. So let's see what we have so far. Well, you guys are experts on this already, so I guess we don't need to do all this stuff here. Let's don't spend so much time here doing this kind of like carpentry of equations and algebra. Let's go over what we need to do, like the concept. So here we have already the forces for this body diagram here, for the vertical element. So we have all the forces, external forces for all the elements So we can start working on the elements itself to calculate forces. For example, we could on the horizontal element, the idea is to find the good points to make our life easier. Look, any suggestion on the right element to find an equation with only one unknown? Any suggestion? What point would you use on the horizontal element to find one unknown directly? I want to listen to your suggestions here on the chat. Moment on C. Yeah, that's a good point. If we do moments on C, we have only this component, and then you can find E, right? Once you can have E, then you can have B. Then what will be the following logic step? What will you do next? Any suggestion? What equation will you use next? We are talking about the horizontal element. Moment about C. Yeah, everybody agrees with moment at C. Perfect. Now we found with moment at C, we found E, the force E. And with force E, we already have force B. So we are moving along. Now summation in the X and in the Y, perfect. If we do summation of forces in the X direction, we can find CX because we already have E, so we have CX. If we have CX here, we already have CX here. Now what will be, and somebody suggested summation of y. Yeah, if we do summation of y, we have cy directly with only one equation, and then we have cy here. So if we have already E and B, we have also B on the vertical element here, and I guess we are done. I don't see anything missing. So we are not going to spend time on the actual equations, but that's how you will do it. All right. Now let's talk about, let's say that they want also for us to find the internal forces at point I and at point H. So, well, you don't need to finish everything for point I, but probably for point H you do. For point I, let me do a diagram here on the side. You have this, let's say this is the vertical element. And then you make a cut at the height of point I. And then you make the free body diagram of that piece where you have down here the vertical force AY. AY here, which is 9.936, and you have the horizontal force 2.855. And then what forces do we have here on the section? This is what is called the section. At the section, let's call it SS, the section, we have horizontal force because we know that this cannot move horizontally because it's a fixed connection with the rest of the beam. There will be also a vertical force because this piece cannot go up and down because it's perfectly joined to the rest of the beam at the section. And this piece cannot rotate. So there will be a moment here, internal moment, at the section that is not allowing this piece, the piece underneath this piece cannot rotate. So, and the, we can call this, let's call it force F, A for axial force. This one I'm gonna call it V. It's a force that usually called V for shear. I don't know why V, let's go with that the V, but many times the shear is called V at the section. Let's call this force at the section, shear at the section, and moment at the section. Actually, since this is point I, let's call it I, and I. Okay. So now we have to analyze those three forces. Same thing as always, summation of moments, summation of forces. Summation of forces, this is very easy here. We have very few forces. Summation of forces in the x direction equals to zero. And I can say positive this direction. So we have VI plus 2.855 equals to zero. So VI equals to minus 2.855, meaning that the force V sub I goes in the other direction. Now, summation of forces in the y direction equals to zero. Let's do positive in this direction. So we have F sub I plus 9.936 equals to zero. So F sub I equals to minus 9.936. I got a minus sign, so it means that I also got the wrong direction here. So it's actually in this direction. And then the moment, summation of moments in, we call it at the section as S. Well, in this case, actually the section is the point I, so summation of moments at the point I equal to zero. I'm gonna do positive in this direction. So I have M sub I minus 2.855 times the distance from here to here. Well, it's not given here, but it was actually the midpoint here, so it's 1.5. What's the midpoint on that height? Just in the middle of this portion here. So it's 1.5, the distance here. 1.5 meters. So this is 1.5 meters. Times 1.5 meters equals to zero. So the moment I is equals to 2.855 times 1.5, 4.28 positive, 4.28 kilonewtons meters. This is kilonewtons. So those are our solutions here. Shear force, axial force, compression in this case, we can put it here, compression, and moment, bending moment. So we can draw here the final answer. At point I, we have a shear force of 2.86, a compressive force of 9.94, and a bending moment of 4.28 kilonewtons meters. Kilonewtons. It will be internal forces at point I. Any question? Pretty straightforward. Yes, pretty straightforward. That's the word. Once we know what we just learned, because that's what I was telling you guys, that what we were learning in the first exam is really important because it's the basis for everything. Once you master free body diagram, summation of forces and summation of moments, how to calculate the moment, the rest becomes very, very easy, very straightforward. So we don't need to spend much time here because most of the time we'll be just setting up the equations and solving the equation, and that's what that with time that we should use doing work here. But what I want to do here is go over a few examples, not necessarily doing the whole example, but doing like the concepts and how those examples could be tackled. I have a bunch of examples here, so we can discuss how to do them, but without doing the whole thing. You might want to finish them later on at your own leisure. Let's start by the first problem here, the one on the top left. In these problems, basically you are asked to find the reactions and the forces of the connections. In the first problem, and basically the actual initial part of this problem is find if there is any element that is subjected to only two forces. Let me see. Why don't you take a look at all the examples here? Do you guys see elements on these graphs that are subjects to only two forces? Okay, my question for you guys. Look at those six frames. Tell me which one of those frames have elements with just two forces. So if we have elements with those two forces, that simplifies the problem a lot. For example, in the frame A, I don't see any element with only two forces. I don't see any single one. Let me do this one for you. Here we can break this into two, the horizontal and the vertical. The horizontal has the forces here at the reactions, has the forces here at the joint. So let me put the forces here, and the forces here at the support. So this could be called CY, CX. This could be called BY, and then this is BY. This is BX, and this is BX, and this will be AY and AX. And then we have a moment, an external moment here, 6 newton meters. So, we have another force here, 200 newtons. So in this first frame A, none of the elements have only two forces, because this one here it has this moment in the middle. So if this moment were not there, this would be an element with only two forces. But because of the element, if it were just like this, then we will have an element with two forces, one force here and one force here. And we will knew that this force has to be in the same direction as this one here. But that's not the case, because we have the moment in the middle. And in the other element here, we have one force here, you know what, and one force here. You know why I said this is one force? Because CX and CY is actually the components of the force at the joint. It's actually one force, the resultant of CX plus CY. That's why I said this is one force and this is one force. That element will be with one force C here and one force B here, and then another force here, 200. Right? Now, if you don't have the force of 200, then you have only two forces on that element. And we know that those two forces has to be like this, right? They have to be in the direction of the element if you have only two forces, which is not the case here, because we have the force of 200 newtons. Make sense? Okay, so tell me about the other frames. Do you guys see any other element in all other frames that have only two forces? CB? C or F at the bottom right, is there two forces, just C and B? Correct. If I do a free body diagram of this element, I would have to put here BX, BY, and I have to put here CY and CX. And this is an element that only has two forces. Somebody will say, no, that's four forces. No, this is actually one force here, because this is just the component of the force. And this will be just one force here. So we actually have two forces. One force at the point B and one force here and one force here. The force at point B and the force at point C. And we know that this, since there are only two forces, the two forces have to follow the connecting line between those two forces. So if we know that this distance is 2 meters and this distance is 1.5 meters, then we know the angle here. So this is just one unknown. Once you know this one, you know this one too, because they have to be equal. So that makes the life very easy on this problem, because this problem has much less number of unknowns. If you don't use to your advantage the fact that this force is equal to this one and that the direction is known, then the problem will take like too many unknowns and will take like double the time. Okay, so we discovered one. This one has two forces. What else? Any other one? Diagram C. Okay, what element in diagram C? Element CD. Yeah, perfect. Same reasoning, right? Element CD has only two forces, and the forces have to have this direction. Could be in the opposite direction, but in this general angle. Okay, so I guess you start to get it. What else? Diagram E. Element BC on diagram. Yeah, element BC. Perfect. This is another element. It has one force here, one force here. It could be in the other direction, right? Since it's an unknown, you assume one of the directions, and once you find the results, if you get a negative sign, then you know that it was in the opposite direction. Okay, now at diagram E. Okay, diagram E, we did already, BC. Any other one? How about D? D? Anything on D? Anything on diagram D? No, nothing, no. Anything on diagram B? I guess we did already B, right? We did already B. Well, we didn't. So that will be, now that you know that those elements have only two forces, then it's kind of easy to solve the same way we did the other problem. So this is kind of like a homework for you to do, but it's not homework, but you should do this. Sorry, what is the question, Antonio? Is element AB on diagram C? AB. Oh, that's a very good question. Element AB is not a two force element, because we have the forces here at B, the forces at A, but you have a moment here. So that moment doesn't count. That is so this element is not only with two forces. It has two forces plus a moment. So it's not a two, this is not a two force element. Very good question, that one. Element AB on diagram C. Very good question on that moment, on that element. Let's do this one. Usually on a frame problem, what you are asked is for the forces on one of the elements, or the forces in all the elements and the reactions on every joint between two elements, or you can be asked for the internal forces on a specific point. For example, in this case, it says the problem, find forces on the member AB and internal forces at point D. So how do you do that? Sometimes you need to calculate the reactions, sometimes you don't, but depends on the complexity of the problem. So the first you do is a few free body diagrams of the elements separated. Like in this case, let's do the free body diagram of element AB. That will be this AB. So this is AB. And then we have the element DC. And this is the element BC. That's DC. Let's do the reactions here. So we have here AX or AY. And here I have BX and BY. BX and BY. If these BX and BY are at a point where two elements are connected, so I have to immediately put the forces on the other element that goes to the same point and put those forces in the opposite directions, because those are action-reaction forces. So you have to be careful that they have to go in the opposite direction in both elements at the same point. Very important. And then the reactions here are CY and CX, and the force of 200 newtons here, 200 newtons. All right, everybody happy. So, I have another moment here. I'm gonna put it in red because those concentrated moments, sometimes you forget about it. So let's put it in red so they are more conspicuous. Some dimensions here, 2 meters, 2 meters, and 1.5 meters. 1.5 meters. All right, so if we are asked for the forces on element AB, probably we don't care much about forces CX and CY, but probably we don't care about those. So let's see what we can get just based on the element AB. If I do summations on moments on the point B, I can find AY. And if I do summation of forces in the Y direction, I can find BY. But there is no way I can find AX or BX. So I have to go into the other element in order to calculate BX, in order to find BX and AX. So let's get started by some equilibrium equations on the free body diagram of element AB. And let's find out AY with a summation of moments of about point B equals to zero. And I'm gonna do positive in this direction. Usually the positive convention that I use is the one that produces my unknown to be positive. So I can have my equation easy to solve. So here I have AY multiplied, but somebody tell me the lever arm of AY with respect to B.
It's 4 meters.
4 meters. 4 meters. Right. 4 meters. Then, what else goes in this equation? Any other forces that go into this equation? Thank you, Emily. Any other? What else goes into this equation?
The moment of the 600.
The six. The 60.
60. Sorry.
The moment, and that one goes in positive or negative.
Positive.
It has the same direction of my convention right here. So 60 newton meters. And that's it. Because with respect to point B, nothing else produces moment. So this is equal to zero. So this is going to be very easy. Equals to minus 60 newton meters over 4 meters. So this is equal to minus 15 newtons. So it gave me negative, so it means that the force is going down, not up. So I make the correction here, and I have my first answer here, which is AY equals to 15 newtons going down. And I can put that into a nice rectangle here. We can find BY by doing a summation of moments in the point A equals to zero, basically the same equation, right? Moments with respect to point A. I'm gonna do positive in this direction. So my force dy is positive. Dy equals dy's. Again, the lever is also 4 meters, right? It's basically the same equation. But now the moment is negative, right? Minus 60 newtons meters. No more forces apply any moment with respect to point A. So this is equal to zero. Therefore, let me increase in my canvas here. Therefore, dy equals to 60 newtons meters over 4 meters equals to 15 newtons. Positive, so it's correct. So dy equals 15 newtons and is going up. It's going up on the element AB. It's going down on the element BC. But since this question is asking me for the forces on element AB, this will be the answer already to my question. So I'm gonna put it on a red rectangle, because that's another of my answers already. So let's continue. So B is 15. So this is 15 here. And AY is also 15 here. Okay, so now we have to go into the diagram of the other element, BC, in order to calculate BX. And that we do with a summation of moments about point C. Free body diagram BC. So I have here a summation of moments about point C equals to zero, positive in this direction, because I want dx to be positive for my equation. So I have dx multiplied by what is the lever arm of the force dx?
Three meters.
3 meters, 3 meters. Any other force produces moment there?
The 200 newtons, right?
Yes, that would be positive or negative?
Negative.
Negative 200 newtons multiplied by 1.5 meters. No more forces produce moment with respect to point C, because the other forces go through the point. So this is equal to zero, therefore Bx equals to positive 200 newtons times 1.5 meters divided by 3 meters. Meters with meters go away, and this is 100 newtons. 100 newtons. And it's positive, it means that the direction that I assumed was correct. So Bx equals to 100 newtons. But I am not going to put a red rectangle here. I'm not gonna do that, because this is not force on the element AB. I would like to do something like this. Maybe on member AB, and then I do Bx equals 100 newtons in this direction, because that's a member, and that one I can do as a rectangle. Okay, I'm putting in red rectangles the answers to my question. My question is, find forces on element AB. So I have Bx, I have By, I have Ax. No, I don't have Ax yet. So I have to do another final equation on the free body diagram. On the free body diagram AB again, free body diagram AB. a very simple equation of forces in the x direction equals to zero, positive to the right. So I have now AX plus 100 equals to zero, then AX equals to minus 100 newtons. So our final element of the forces on element AB equals to 100 newtons in the x direction, going backward. So that will be this. So I have to correct that one here on the initial diagram. This is going in this direction, okay? Okay? Okay, at this moment, I would like, I hope you guys are pretty familiar with how to calculate reactions, how to do these free body diagrams, put all the forces on the elements, set up summation of moments about this point or that point, multiply forces by the right distance in order to calculate the right moment, and from those equations calculate your unknowns. And that's what we have to do all the time. I hope at this point you guys are getting good at this. What follows is basically based on the same principle. So let's continue now. So basically what we found here was the reactions on the element AB. And we have to do a little trick going over the element BC in order to calculate the horizontal forces on the element AB. Because basically those horizontal forces here, AX and BX, are due to the 200 Newton force that is pulling the element BC. That's why we have to get into that element in order to calculate those forces. Now we're going to calculate the internal forces on the point D. For that, we are going to make a cut through point D in order to see those forces. If you don't make a cut, you don't see the forces. Let me move that diagram down. This is the element AB. Then we have the 60 newtons meter here, and we have the point D here. So we're going to make a cut here, and we're going to draw the element just up to that point. Look what this made me do. So at this point D, we make a cut. We have the reactions AX going like that, 15 newtons. We have the point, the 60, we have these 2 meters, 3 meters. Two meters, 1 meter. Here we have the moment of 60 newton meters. We have another force AX going down. AX is 15 newtons going down. So this is the diagram of the element AB, but cut, actually the member AD, we cut at the point D. When you cut at the point D, you will see three forces there. One force
that's— Professor, why is it 1 meter?
Oh, because the point D is in the middle of that section here. Here, this is 1 meter, 1 meter.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, it doesn't say anywhere, but I just put it in the middle of the element.
Okay.
Thank you.
So
this is called the shear force at D. This force is trying to cut the element I was showing last time like this, trying to cut like that. That's what is called shear force. Now there is another force, an axial load that we call it FD, that is trying to stretch the element or compress the element, FD. And there is a moment, I'm gonna call it MD, that is trying to bend the beam, bend it like that, right? Bend. I put these three internal forces in the positive convention. We will discuss sign convention for shear and moment in the next class. For now, the convention for the axial load is tension positive, compression negative. So that one I put it in tension, as you see there, in the positive direction. In order to find these three forces, you basically make a moment about the point where you made the cut to calculate the moment at that point. And you make it at the point where you made the cut so you can eliminate the two other unknowns, shear and axial. That's the reason why you make the moment at that point. So then you will have here moment at point D equal to zero. And I'm gonna do positive in this direction as I always do. I do positive in a way that the unknown that I want to find is positive. So here I will have MD minus 60, because the 60 goes opposite in the opposite direction, plus 15 newtons from the vertical force multiplied by how many meters? Candela abandoned me. Someone that replaces Candela.
No, I'm here.
There is no more. No
what was the question?
What is the lever arm of the 415 newtons with respect to point D?
It's still four.
No.
Right?
No.
Oh, three.
Fermín. Gracias. Gracias, Carolina. Okay, any more forces that produce moment with respect to point D? No, no more forces. So equals to zero. Therefore, more MD is equals to 60 minus 45 newtons meters. The moment D is equal to 15 newton meter. I get a positive, so it's correct. Okay, so that's the first answer to those internal forces. Now, a simple summation of forces in the y direction. Summation of forces in the y direction equal to zero. Positive going down. I will have VD plus 15 newtons equals to zero. VD equals minus 15 newtons. So my direction was wrong. So I have to fix it. This is actually going up, right? So then I put here VD equals 15 newtons going up. And that's my other answer here. Okay. And now a simple summation of forces in the x direction equals to zero. I'm gonna do positive going to the right. And I have FD minus 15 newtons equals to zero. Therefore, FD equals to 15. I got positive. So what does it mean that is positive? That is tension, right? Right. Great. Okay. And that's the end of it. Maybe we can make a final diagram here with the shear force, 15 newtons, axial force, 15 newtons, and the moment, oh, the moment in what direction was? Positive, so I should put it here also. And the moment, 15 newtons meters. I don't know if I made a mistake somewhere because I'm not getting the same result, but well, maybe we made a mistake here and there on our operation, a calculation, but what is important is to understand what we did here, okay? Yeah, I have 100 for Bx. Oh, yes, Ax is 100, so actually this is 100. I don't know where I put here 15, this is 100. So this is 100 here. Sorry, this is 100 here. So this is 100 here. So this force is 100. Other than that, should be okay. Yes. Good, okay, so let's make another example with a little addition on the loading. We did, I went over this very quickly.
Yes, sir. Yes? Will internal forces always have a moment?
I would say in general, yes. Because when you have an element that is continuous, and you make a cut, this element, the element on the left doesn't rotate with respect to the element on the right. If they rotate with respect to each other, well, they will break. You will have this situation, right? So there is always an internal moment that is not allowing the rotation. You only get rotation when the element breaks. So I would say in general, yes, I was thinking, if you have a connection, but it's actually two elements. If you have a connection, you have an element connected to another element with a pin, and you make a cut on the pin, well, there is no moment, but there is not like an internal, it's like the force, you will be calculating the forces in the connection. And then you have a vertical force, horizontal force, this will could be called a shear force, could be called a shear force, and this could be called an axial force. But there will be no moment because due to the pin, they are free to rotate with respect to each other and they don't break. In this case, you don't find moment. You see the shear force, you see the axial force, but I wouldn't consider this like the internal forces on an element, but the forces on a connection. If it's a continuous element like this, wherever you want to break it to analyze the internal moments, there will be a moment because the material doesn't allow for a free rotation. And that will be the purpose of our analysis in the following days. We are going to find the internal forces as shear and moment. We are not going to analyze axial loads anymore. Axial loads were very important in trusses and will be very important in columns. But we will be analyzing moments and shear on beams, which are the elements that the effects that are more important on beams. On beams, the axial force is not so important because beams usually don't hold too much axial load, and their design are governed by the moment and the shear mainly. Okay, let's go for another problem. We have two elements. We are going to find the forces on the element AB and the internal forces at point D. In order to find the forces on the element AB, we are going to break it also like we did in the previous problem. We have element AB and element BC. Element BC is a very simple element with forces in only two points, so we know that the forces have to follow this direction, right? Because it has forces only in two points. So this force will be applied here also. Let's call it force at B. Force at B. So this is force at B. Then we have a vertical force AY and a horizontal force AX. And then we have our famous force distributed load. Imagine this is, for example, a wall, that you have a wall on top of that beam. So a wall sitting on that beam doesn't apply a concentrated load at any point. It's a load that applies a load of 400 newtons for every meter of length of the wall. So if this wall has a length of 3 meters, so it's going to apply 1200 newtons on the whole length of the wall or the beam, right? So you have the beam here, 1 meter, 1 meter, 2 meter, 3 meter, another meter here, another meter here. And the way you draw this uniformly distributed loads is by drawing all these little arrows going down. The number of arrows that you draw here doesn't matter. You can put more, you can put less, doesn't matter. It's just a matter of representing the fact that there are loads all over the beam, all over the beam you have load. And in this case, you have 400 newtons for every meter of length. So in this first meter, you will have 400 newtons. In this second meter, you will have another 400 newtons. And in this one, you will have another 400 newtons. So the total amount of load on the whole beam is 1200 newtons. So we eventually could replace that force by one unique force of 1200 newtons that we will have to apply in the center of gravity of the whole load. Since this is uniformly distributed, the center of gravity is going to be in the middle here. That will not be the case if the load is distributed like a triangle. If you see that the load is like a triangle, you can easily see that the equivalent concentrated load has to be like moved to the right, because the triangle has more load on this side than on this side, right? So the idea is that you have to put it in the place where it's kind of like makes sense, like has a balance. So for a rectangle, it's easy to see that it's right in the middle, and that's how we are going to do this problem. Later, we are going to find triangular loading like this, so we have to find the center of gravity of the triangle that is not going to be in the middle. All right, make sense? Make sense, everybody?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay, then let's proceed. Let's proceed. I'm gonna erase all this. And how do you calculate that 1200? Well, you calculate that 1200.
Profe, I have a question.
Yes.
So we are adding F of B there to avoid having that L-shaped member, or the backwards L shape.
Well, we need to find this FB. We need to find it. So how are we going to find it? So we have to go back down to this element here, and that's where we see that the FB has a direction that we know, because we know that this is 1 meter and this is 1 meter. And based on this diagram is that we can draw this force here, FB, in that direction, based on that diagram that I have on the here. Based on this diagram, we know that. That's how we can draw this force here.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Okay. Thank you.
If we don't have this, what will happen if we don't have that diagram? If we do like this with AY here, AX here, and then we will have here BY, and BX, right? And then the load here. We will never be able to find BX. or be Y. See, there is no way. In this diagram, we have four unknowns. And how many equations can we have in a given free body? Three equations.
Three.
So this problem cannot be solved. Now, that's why we need the L-shaped element in order to find out that the direction of FB is the direction of the line that joins point B with point C. And then we know the direction of the force FB. Now that we know the direction, these two unknowns become just one, just FB. And we know the angle is 45 degrees. So knowing the angle, this reduces to one unknown. Okay? So the L-shaped element is very important in order to let us find, solve the problem. So let's do it. So with a free body diagram of element AB, we can do summation of moments about point, for example, B equals to zero in order to find AY. So I'm gonna do positive in this direction. So this equation will be AY, again, the lever arm here. Anybody? Only Candela's with me. Where is everybody? What is the lever arm of AY with respect to B?
Three.
Thank you, Candela. Okay. A3. Any other forces produce moment with respect to B?
The 400 newtons times 3.
Right. It's actually then the 400 newtons is actually, remember that we have the 400 newtons per meter, 400 newtons per meter multiplied by 3 meters. So this is, we do.
It'd be negative 1200 times 1.5.
Right, this is the 1200 force that is equivalent to the distributed force. So that will be negative 1200 newtons multiplied by how much?
1.5.
Multiplied by 1.5, because that's the lever arm from the 1200 force to the point B. All right. And no more forces, right? No more forces. Therefore, AY equals to positive 1200 newtons times 1.5 meters divided by 3 meters. So equals to 600 newtons. So AY equals 600 newtons going up because we got a positive number. So this answer goes in the right direction. Next, let's find FB. Summation of moments with respect to point A equals to zero, positive in this direction. Question, Lisandro?
Oh no, my bad.
Okay, summation of moments with respect to point A equals to zero. I'm going to do based on the components of FP, which are this and this. This will be FBX, sorry, FBY. So it will be FBY times 3, right? Plus 1200 newtons times 1.5 meters equals to zero. FBX doesn't produce any moment because it goes through the point A, right? So FBY is equal to FB sine of 45 degrees times 3 meters plus 1201.5, which is 1800 newton meters. Equal to zero, so FB is equal to minus 1800 newton meters divided by 3 meters sine of 45 degrees. Somebody can make this operation real quick. 848.53 negative. Negative means that it's in the opposite direction. So this is actually in this direction, 848.53 newtons. So we have now, that will be another answer here, FB equals 848.53 newtons, actually 849 newtons in this direction with respect to, we're talking about element AB. What else we need here? Summation of forces in the X direction. Summation of forces in the X direction equals to zero. I'm gonna do positive in this direction. So I have AX minus 848.53 newtons cosine of 45 degrees equals to zero. So AX equals to 600 newtons positive. So it means that the direction is correct. AX, so we have here AX equals 600 newtons in this direction. So that's another one that goes for our results. Perfect. Okay. Any question up to there, up to that point? Any question up to that point that was just calculation of reactions? Now we go to internal forces at point D, right? So let's move that diagram down here and let's make a free body diagram of element. Well, you have the element AB. Actually, we don't need the whole element. We have here the forces at the A point. Then the whole force, this one here, and then the force here. But then we're going to make a cut here at point D. So at point D, we have a portion of the distributed load that is just 1 meter long, a force AX of 600 newtons and a force AY of 600 newtons, and then our internal forces, well, our 400 newtons per meter, and our shear force V sub D, our axial force F sub D, and our moment M sub D. Those are our internal forces. And it's very simple to calculate them. It's just summation of moments about point D in order to find the moment. Positive in this direction. So I have moment of D plus the force of 400 newton meters, that in this case, what would be the concentrated volume equivalent to 400 newton meters? What will be that force? The green one that I draw right there? 400. It's actually 400 Newton meters per 1 meter, right? Multiply by what is the lever arm of that force with respect to point D?
0.5 meters.
That 0.5 is this distance, 0.5 meters here. And that's it, equals to zero. So moment D is equal. Oh, no. I'm missing one force, right? I'm missing one force. What force I am missing? 600. Yes, 600. Positive or negative?
Negative.
Negative. Yes, negative. 600. And the lever arm, 1 meter. Equals to zero. So I have moment D equals to 600 Newton meter minus 200 Newton meters. So MD equals 400 Newton meters. I got positive, so it's correct. It's in this direction. Okay, now summation of forces in the y direction equals to zero, positive going down. So I have VD plus 400 Newton meter by 1 meter minus 600 Newtons equals to zero. So VD equals to 600 minus 400 Newtons. So VD equals 200 positive. So it's correct that it's going down. Let's put our little rectangle. And then summation of forces in the x direction equals to zero, positive to the right, FD minus 600 equals to zero, therefore FD equals to 600 is correct, so it's tension. So those are the internal forces. Okay.